Well, good morning, church family. How are you this morning? If you are able, why don't you stand to your feet this morning? Are you excited to be in this place, worshiping our God this morning? All right, let's sing this out.
I'm coming with a heart of worship. I'm bringing in a brand new song. I'm hanging to see the unthinkable. I'm ready for a miracle.
Heart's praying like a fresh encounter. Souls looking to the living God. I'm ready for a real revival. Oh, Holy Spirit.
So much more. We're looking to a new horizon. We're praying for your rain to pour. An overflowing of the new redemption. An overflowing of your kingdom. I'm ready for a real
morning. Anybody ready? All right, let's sing this together. Here we go.
Oh, can you feel it? Heaven is reaching.
That's it.
Oh, can you hear it? Our God is speaking. Oh, can you see it? He's got your healing.
Yes, he does.
Oh, just receive it. Receive the free.
Sing it, man. Come on.
Oh, can you feel?
Heaven is reaching.
Heaven is reaching.
Oh, can you hear?
Oh, can you hear?
Our God is speaking.
Our God is speaking.
Oh, can you see?
I'll get the offer.
This morning, what's going on? Hey, can we say hello to everybody that's joining us online real quickly? Can we do that today? We're glad that you're here. Thanks for joining us. Hey, we have some special guests. Did anybody show up last night for what was called Gospel Night? Oh my goodness, wow. Hey, if you missed out last night, listen, it won't be the last one, but I do want to introduce to you a couple of new friends of the Met. The first one is right over here to my left. This is Wes Hampton with the Gaither Vocal Band. Give it up for Wes. Incredible, incredible human being and a great voice, but a better dude, man. So thankful that you're here. And over here to my right is Marshall Hall, also sang with the Gaithers for years and years. Yes. Now a worship leader in Orlando, Florida, and such a dear friend. We're really glad that you're here. So, yeah, man, it's awesome. And we're going to sing some more. We'll do a couple of gospel songs. We're just going to have some fun this morning, okay? So before we do that, listen, if you're visiting with us, this is not normal, but we wish it was. So if you could convince them to come move to Houston like we were talking about earlier, that would be great. Take just a second, turn to somebody right there beside you, give them a high five and say, hey, let's do this, all right? Hey, would it be okay if we did a little Southern gospel? Would that be all right? If you didn't grow up listening to this music, that's okay, but you still got to get your hands together because it's really hard to sing with people staring at you, okay? So come on, get your hands going. Come on.
Hey,
help me out.
Hey, hey.
All right. Tell us a story, Marsh. Come on. It
goes like this. I was on my way to California, leaving New York City far behind. Life was like a bundle of confusion. I was looking for a love that I could never find. So I tuned into a gospel station. I heard about a sweet salvation. And then I gave it all to Him, my heart, my soul, and my mind. About him, oh, 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 got a strange suspicion. I'm wondering about your condition. I said I've had a taste of what it means to be alive. Hey, whoa. Talking about him. No, 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 no.
Marsha, lead us in something.
I'm thinking. Missing something first.
I know you got questions in the corners of your mind. Traces of discouragement, peace you cannot find. Reflections of your old past, they seem to face you every day. This one thing I know for sure is Jesus is the way.
Sing this.
Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other, 'cause Jesus is the way. And Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other, 'cause Jesus is the way. Now I know you got mountains that you think you cannot climb. Say your skies are dark and you think the sun won't shine. Well, in case you don't know, I'm here to tell you that the word of God is true, yeah. And everything he's promised people, I know he will do it for you. Sing it out, church. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other, 'cause Jesus is the way. And Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other,
is the way.
Jesus is the way.
Sing that again. Over your family, church, Jesus. Over your family, church, Jesus is the way. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. He's our master, Savior, oh Jesus. Like the fragrance after the rain, Jesus,
sing it over,
Jesus,
oh,
Jesus, let all heaven and earth proclaim that kings and kingdoms, they'll all pass away, but there's something about that Jesus is the sweetest name I know. Does anybody out there know that name? And he's just the same as his lovely name, and that's the reason why I love him so. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, my Jesus is the sweetest name I know. Boys, why don't you help me sing this song? Kings and kingdoms, they're brings power. Amen. In the church this morning, sing this. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, because I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Oh, I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break.
Get on out of here, devil.
Declaring there is hope and there is freedom.
I speak Jesus. Hey, yeah.
Your name is high.
Shadows burn light. Jesus from the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Amen.
Jesus for my family, declare it. I speak the holy name, Jesus.
And we're not done, we're not done.
Oh, shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Oh, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name.
Just between services, interrupted by two of our family right here at the Met, dealing with severe health crisis. They said, you know, Pastor Matt, elders, it says in Scripture, if anyone's sick, call the elders of the church together, have a prayer meeting. So we had a prayer meeting between services, praying that the very name that we just sang, praying that the healing of God would flow. Can I just ask a question? I've asked this before, but can I just, if you need healing in your life, I'm serious, would you just raise your hand right now? You need to be healed of something. Keep them up. I want you to look around. Number one, you're not in the valley by yourself. You got a family that loves you. But number two, you serve a God who can pick you up out of the deepest pit and can set you on the top of a mountain and can say, no. Don't let the enemy speak to you right now. By my name, by my power, says the Lord, all things are possible. Everything. I think we overcomplicate it because we try to make sure we've got all of our plans lined up. We've got to have everything in place. And Jesus says, yeah, or you could just come to me. He says, my burden is light and my name is life. There's no promises in that prayer, but there is hope in that prayer because hope has a name and his name is Jesus. So here's what I want you to do. Everyone's hands up. I know you didn't grow up Pentecostal. You'll get over it. I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Keep them high. Over every heart and every mind. Because I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Sing it again. I just want to speak the name. Yeah, I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Till every dark addiction, lift it up. Till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there's freedom. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Now, I want you to sing it like you believe it. Your name is power.
'Cause your name is power.
That's it.
Your name is healing.
Your name is life.
Your name is life.
Yes, it is.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire. Oh, oh, oh. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your
take those same hands and just turn them like this. What if God wanted to just put something in your lap today? Maybe it's a truth from that song. Maybe you came today empty. You're not real sure what's going on, but you just need to feast at the table of the Lord today. Anybody?
My vessel is empty that once I had plenty. My soul is barren and dry. Somewhere flows a fountain beyond distant mountain. Let me drink from the river of life. Lord, feed your children as we stand here willing to eat from the table of life. Drink from the fountain that flows from the mountain. Let me feast from the Father's supply. So long I have hungered, no man could number the days that I've longed to be. I've longed to be in a land filled with honey, where the rivers are running. Very soon now I'll taste and I'll see.
Anybody ready to see?
So, Lord, feed your children as we stand here willing to eat from the table of life. Dream that flows from the mountain. Let me feast from the Father's supply.
Oh, drink from the fountain.
Drink from the fountain that the Father's
God, in your presence in this place, I thank you for such talented people. I thank you, God, for brotherhood. We know, God, that it's not in song that we find unity, but God, it's in brotherhood and sisterhood underneath the blanket of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And we want a feast from the table today. We want you to communicate to our very soul. We want your word to be alive and active and sharper than any two-edged sword and piercing to the division of the soul and the spirit, the joints of the marrow. God, discern the intentions of our heart. And Father, give us the courage to respond, knowing that your table is waiting, full of mercy, full of grace, and full of goodness. For everything from you is good. We worship you in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, I think I could have the worst sermon in the world and it would still be awesome today. Wow. Did you guys appreciate that? Gosh. How many of you think you sound that good singing in the shower? Anybody else? We deceive ourselves, don't we? Well, my name's Scott. So glad you guys are here. I want to welcome everyone who's joining us online, wherever you might be. We love you. We're grateful for you. Come on, give it up for everyone who's out there. Love you guys. If this is your first time here at the Met, we're really grateful as well. We know that coming to a church for the first time can be a little bit intimidating, maybe even overwhelming, because you don't know what to expect. Are they weird people? Are they goofy people? What's going on inside that place? And yes, we are weird, goofy people, and hopefully you feel right at home, so we love you. Let's give a big warm welcome to anyone who might be here for the first time. Glad you're here. We're gonna wrap up the series that we've been going through all summer long through the Gospel of John. But before we get there, I want to mention that right here on campus, beginning on Wednesday nights in the fall, we've got some great classes and studies for you that you can engage with. And to find out more about them, we've got some of them out in our lobby today. You can check out some of the stuff and the books that go with it. And you can also sign up for a class or a study today through your Met Church app, or just go online at themet.church/events or classes. It'll all get you there. We'd love to have you come on out and join us on Wednesday nights this fall. It's going to be a really good time. How many of you guys brought your Bibles? Say, got it?
Got it.
All right, so if you got it, open it up to John chapter 17. And here's the thing, if you're not familiar with the Bible, we're still so glad that you're ready to engage with it. It's the 43rd book from the beginning, so just kind of count and go through or scroll down to John. It's the fourth book in the New Testament to chapter 17. And before we get into like the text of chapter 17, let me kind of review the overview of this Gospel of John that we talked about in week one in the beginning of the summer. And we realized that literally in these 21 chapters, there is a purpose statement for the book that is lucid clear in the Gospel. And it's in chapter 20. Let me read it to you. It'll be on the screen as well. And here's what it says in the NIV translation. Chapter 20, verse 30 says, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. You ever wonder, well, what else did he do? If he walked on water, he turned water to wine, and he healed people, he raised them from the dead. Like, what else could he have done that God chose not to put in Scripture? Just amazing. Verse 31 says, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. The purpose of this book is evangelical. It's to be a witness for who Jesus is, what he said, and what he's done, so that we can believe in him and find life in his name. And if you think about the book in its kind of its entirety, it starts in chapter 1 from a cosmic point of view, talking about in the beginning, which is pointing back to Genesis 1 in the beginning in the creation account. And it literally will go on to point out rather clearly that Jesus and God the Father and the Holy Spirit, this mysterious this Trinity that is mind-boggling, coexist, and Jesus is there in the beginning of creation. He becomes human, God in the flesh, and walks amongst us. So chapter 1 is this cosmic point of view on who Jesus is. He is deity. And then it goes into Jesus saying 7 profound statements, all that begin with 2 words, I am. He says, I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. And he says these 7 statements that after he says them, he does a miracle to confirm what he just said. There's these 7 signs in the book of John that go to confirm the 7 I am statements. And then we get to chapter 13. And it spends like 5 chapters recording a conversation around a meal with his 12 disciples. We call it the Last Supper. He talks about and models what it looks like to be a servant. He mentions his betrayal that's coming real soon that starts in chapter 18. He talks about the Holy Spirit. There's more talk about the Holy Spirit from the mouth of Jesus in the book of John than any other place in what Jesus has said. And he talks about a lot of things in this Last Supper. And what's going to happen is the next day, the weekend begins of his going to the cross and being raised from the dead. And we get into chapter 17, and after he's talked to all of his disciples about these things, he starts to talk to the Heavenly Father on behalf of his disciples. He starts to pray for them. Now, at this point, there's only 11 left because one leaves. Because he left to go betray Jesus. His name is Judas. And so, this is a prayer that Jesus prays for these 11 men. But then he'll expand the audience, which we'll see in just a minute. So, if you got your Bible, you're in John 17. Let's look at this. And I'm going to read through the first 5 verses. Verse 1, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Jesus says, it says this, after all these things, what things? That they talked about around that meal, Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. What hour is that? That's the weekend that's coming up. His betrayal, his crucifixion, his ultimate resurrection. Jesus prays, glorify your Son so that he can give glory back to you. For you have given him authority over everyone. He gives eternal life to each one you have given him. Now, pause for just a moment. Who has the power to give eternal life? None but God. So there's rich, rich theology right out of the gate in this conversation he's having with the Father. Verse 3, he says, and this is the way to have eternal life. If you've ever wondered, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Here's what he says. To know you, God the Father, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, the one you sent to earth. There's actually, no other way. Verse 4 says this. He says, I brought glory to you here on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. Now, Father, bring me into the glory that we shared before the world began. So he points back to his pre-creation of the earth, his existence pre-creation. But then he goes on, he starts to pray for these 11 men. And let's just kind of scan through here for a moment, looking at some of the things that he prayed. Go down to verse 11. Verse 11, he prays this. Protect them by the power of your name so that they will be united just as we are. Now, why would Jesus pray that these 11, this is who he's praying for in this moment specifically and explicitly. Why would he pray that these 11 men, that God would protect them by the power of his name and that they would stay united? It's because in just a matter of days, they're going to face more resistance, more struggle, more persecution than they could ever imagine. And Jesus is praying, hold them together. Hold them together. Let's keep going. Go down to verse 15. In verse 15, Jesus prays. He says this, I'm not asking that you take them out of the world. Anybody ever pray that? Like, Lord, take me out of here. This place is crazy. He does the opposite. He's like, keep them in. Keep them in. Keep them in the game. He says, I'm not asking that you take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. There is an evil one. There is a spiritual enemy for all of us. Verse 17, let's go down that and look at that verse. He prays, make them holy, or basically set them apart, sanctify them, make them distinct amongst everyone else. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. So Jesus has these 11 men sitting at the table, and he's five chapters in to this conversation. He begins to pray, Father, protect them by the power of your name. Keep them as one. Protect them from the evil one. And set them apart to be distinctively different, set apart for the purposes of our Creator. And set them apart by your truth. Your word is truth. And I look at this, and I can't speak for you, but I don't know if you might be able to relate. I look at how Jesus prays for these 11 men, and I start to think, man, my prayers are kind of wishy-washy compared with that stuff. I'm like, you know, Lord, bless the green beans. Like, please. Thank you for the double-double animal style and all the other good stuff. And I don't know if you can relate to that, but Jesus isn't praying that kind of stuff. It's an entirely different approach. And I read through this, and it makes me think of one of my very best friends, a mentor to me. His name is Al. I want to just take a minute and introduce you to my friend Al. He's not going to walk out. I'm just going to tell you a story about Al. Al lives in Michigan, and he and his wife Agnes are dear friends to Shelley and I. When I was a children's pastor at our church in Michigan, it was a rather large church. I was the elementary kids pastor. And we had 1,000 kids from kindergarten to fifth grade. We had 6 church services a week and 4 outreach events every week that my team was responsible for. So he was working a lot, and we were working hard. Al's wife was my administrative assistant. Honestly, she was the one who made everything work, so that's just the truth. She's awesome. Al worked at a company called Zondervan Publishing. At that time, was the world's largest Christian publisher. Al never got a college education. He started sweeping floors in the warehouse of Zondervan when he was a teenager in his early 20s. And as Zondervan grew and would become ultimately at that time the largest Christian publishing company in the world, Al grew along with the company and became vice president. And Al was served as a volunteer in our children's ministry. Just an incredible leader, incredibly humble. And he took me under his wing and would mentor me for several years. Al would literally go on as almost becoming the president of Zondervan. Strange circumstances, he didn't, and shortly after, the company kind of went sideways, and they were acquired by another publisher called Thomas Nelson, who is now the largest Christian publisher in the world. And Al was the point guy that ran the merging of those two companies together. Just an amazing guy. And as he invested in my life, what would happen is over the years, as I would go back to Michigan and speaking at churches up there, I'd end up staying at Al and Agnes's house 3 or 4 times a year up until, I mean, still do. If I go up there and we're in the area, we'll stay at their house. And inevitably, we'd have a great time. We'd enjoy some good food. We'd sit in there in their house watching cheesy television shows, just laughing like crazy, talking about the good old days. And then there'd come times where Al would just begin to pour into my life. And he'd ask all these questions, and you know, we'd end up in the morning sitting at the breakfast table and drinking coffee, and he'd say, hey, how's Shelly doing? And he calls her Officer Shelly, and there's a reason. I'll tell you that story some other time. Shelly knows full well you're in here. You know exactly what I'm talking about. How's Officer Shelly doing? And then they know our kids. How are Ashley and Morgan and Dylan, and how are you and Shelly doing? How's your marriage? How are you doing as a father? How's your ministry going? And because I know he loves me, and he's always been a champion for me. I told him the truth because I know he wants my best. So I, you know, always end up telling Al my biggest struggles. And he'd listen. He wouldn't try to fix me. He wouldn't try to rescue me. And he just let me share. And eventually, he'd say, Scott, let's pray. And at that point, I knew what was coming. Because Al walks with Jesus. And he would start to pray, pretty basic. He'd be like, Father God, I thank you for Scott. Thank you for Shelley. Thank you for the kids. Thank you, God, that you're blessing them. And I just pray that you'd provide for them. And then he'd start to warm up while he's praying. And I'd start to buckle up while he's praying. Because then his pace would increase and his passion would be notched up a bit. And he'd start to pray things. He'd say, God, I thank you that Scott's not here by mistake. God, I thank you that you've got a calling on his life. And no man, no devil can take away what you've given him. Because God, the door that you open, no man can shut. And God, I thank you for Shelley. And I thank you that the blood of Jesus Christ has washed her sin. And I thank you for Ashley and Morgan and Dylan. And God, I pray that you'd protect them, that you'd surround them, and that you'd bring them to their destiny in life. And then he'd get up and he'd start walking around. And I'm like, man, this is Al. And he'd start pacing around the kitchen. I'm just sitting there like, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. And he'd start walking. He'd walk up behind me, put his hands on my shoulder. This is like whenever I visit, like this is my thing I'm looking forward to, you know. And he put his hands on my shoulders and he would just say, Satan, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. You have no hold on Scott. Jesus is his Savior. God is his protector. So I just declare that he will live and experience the fullness of God in his life. And he just started walking around and praying some more. And he would go on. And I'd just sit there like, man, he's not praying for the green beans. This dude is laying it down. He's praying prayers around mission and calling and destiny. And this is what Jesus is doing right here. He's praying for these men. That this movement of God that's bursting forth in the world, the kingdom of God, where the God of this Jewish people is now breaking out into the Gentile world and to a people who have no idea of the story of God and who have all these apprehensions against the idea of a creator, and he's praying missional prayers for them. God, protect them by the power of your name. Keep them as one. Sanctify them by your truth. And then he prays for a different group of people. Go down to verse 20. In John 17, verse 20, Jesus continues with his prayers and he says this, I pray not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. How many of you think that includes you? You trace the message of Jesus that you've heard, if you're a follower of Christ, that you've believed, will ultimately be traced back to these guys. And Jesus says, I'm praying for them. Verse 21, he says, I pray that they will all be one. Everybody say one. Just as you and I are one, and as you are in me, Father, and I am in you, and may they be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. Go down to verse 23. As he continues to pray, he says, may they experience, they, that's us, the followers of him who believe this message through these guys, may they experience such perfect unity. Everybody say unity. Such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. The missional prayer Jesus prays for you, Sam, and for me, for you, John, and for me, for you, Gabby, and for me, for all of us, is that we have uncommon unity. An uncommon unity. Well, unity around what, Scott? Well, from a macro level, unity around the most important things, that God the Father is God the Creator, that you and I are created in His image, that the thing in us that's all twisted up and the desire to go contrary to who God is and what He says is that brokenness and sin within us has been redeemed as God is pursuing us in relationship, bringing us back to Himself through Jesus, the Son of God, God in the flesh, who died on the cross and rose from the dead, and there is no other name under heaven by which anyone can be saved, unity around those kinds of things. That when we look for truth and we say, man, and all the opinions and all the conversations and the disagreements, what is really at the end of the day, what is true and what is dependable? God's Word. We unite around those things. And when you and I meet someone who's a follower of Jesus, there's a unity, there's a bond that we already have. And as we look even in the city of Houston, what is it now, the fourth largest city in the U.S., arguably the most diverse city in the country. And if you look around the Met, increasingly diverse as the community here becomes more and more diverse. And yet in all of our different opinions and our different convictions, our different likes and dislikes, we unify around Jesus. And it brings us together. And we have this fellowship, this koinonia, this bond around the table that says, man, you have that preference, you have that opinion, you would do life certain things this way, you would vote that way, but yet we embrace, we say, but Jesus is what brings us together. And in that bigger picture of unity, kind of at a micro level, we go, well, what do we unify around as a church? Like if we're all like, all right, we're on the same page with that, but what do we unify around the micro level? And that's where it gets a little more dicey, a little more challenging, right? Like, I like this music, I like that music, right? I like when Pastor Matt speaks, not when Scott, you know, whatever it is. But at the Met, we unify around those things I just mentioned first and foremost will always be above and beyond at the micro level. But what we unify around is inviting people into meaningful relationship with God and each other. That's why we're here. That's why we exist. We want to be a people that are about relationships first. And not superficial relationships, but meaningful relationships. Someone say, hey Scott, how do I share my faith? It's actually, the starting point is super easy. Just invite someone into relationship. Be someone's friend. People aren't a box to check, they're a soul to invest in. Invite people into meaningful relationship with God and with each other. That's what we're all about. We're all about following Jesus, being disciples of Jesus who want to make other disciples of Jesus. So what else does it look like? Like here at the Met, what do we unite around? I'm going to show you a picture on the screen. We call it the engine of the local church. And I just want to introduce some of this thinking to you if you're newer here at the Met. As you take a look at that, just look at it real quick and then I'll talk about it for a moment. You've got, as, you know, as you come into our gatherings, we have join a group, engage God's word, love the church, soul care, lift the city. You got it memorized? You're good? Okay, you can take it down now. Pop quiz, what was the second? No, I'm just kidding. But as the Met, we unite around, we rally around, because we're about relationships first, and we believe that making disciples happens best in the context of relationship, we constantly invite you to join a group, to invite you into relationship. Not just transparent relationship. You know, transparency is, Richie, where I can tell you some of my story, but I control the narrative. I'm going to let you in, but just enough so I can control what you think about me. But if I get vulnerable with you, Richie, I'm going to tell you some things that you could judge me if you so chose. But because you're a follower of Jesus and you value relationship, it's grace. So there is no shame in meaningful relationships. And as we walk together as followers of Jesus and we look at the scriptures and we pray for one another and we discuss how do we apply the teachings of God's word to our everyday lives, we start to become disciples who make disciples. And then because we watch each other do it, we can go do it with other people. It's reproducible and it's intentional. Join a group is what you're invited into here at the Met. And then if you can try to remember that graphic, there's a part that says engage God's word. Whether or not you realize it, we're going to be a Bible people. We are a Bible people. We believe that Scripture is God's word to us, that it's infallible and it's true. And we want you to be a Bible person. We want you to read Scripture. If reading is a struggle for you, listen to it, an audio, whatever it is, dig in, study it, get together and talk about God's word with people. That's what you're invited in. This is what we unite around. Join a group. Engage God's word. Another aspect of it was love the church. What's it mean to love the church? Like in community and family, I love the church through serving and through giving. Did you know right now there are a lot of kids outside those walls that are being loved on right now? They're safe, they're loved, and they're being taught how much Jesus loves them. And that's because people are over there investing in your kids. They love their church, they love you by serving in their church. They're reaching their community through serving in their church. We are a church of people who serve. We're also a people who give. It's amazing how Jesus says, wherever our heart is, you can find our heart wherever our money is. And the door to our heart is through our pocketbook. It's scary, and I wish it was different than that. But we are a church that believes in giving. We believe in tithing. We believe in being generous and investing in the lives of other people. I join a group. I engage God's word. I love my church. Through serving and giving. What else do we unite around? We unite around something called soul care. What is soul care? Soul care is the reality that every single one of us carry brokenness in different parts of our lives. There are seasons, let me put it this way, there are seasons in each of our lives, followers of Jesus even, that we need care for our soul, where we're broken, where there's an addiction, there's a habit, there's a hang-up, there's an unhealthy something in us that we need to find freedom in Jesus. And I just want you to know that as you walk through soul care here at the Met, and we all need it at different times, there is no shame in your brokenness because brokenness is normal at the Met. And if that scares you away, I'm sorry. See you later. But if that makes you feel welcome, come on in because we all need Christ. I join a group. I engage in God's word. I love my church. I'm in soul care. And then I lift the city. And we talk about lifting the city at the Met. It's that we literally are asking God to use us, every single one of us, as a church to lift some of the burden in our city. To serve with compassion. Meet the needs of people. Yes, so that we can introduce them to Jesus. But also because they're human beings. We want to be a church that lifts our city. And so when Jesus prays for those 11 disciples soon to become apostles, he prays, God, protect them by the power of your name. Protect them from the evil one. Set them apart. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And then he says, and Father, I'm going to pray for even those who will believe in me through their message over the centuries that you make them one. And we unite around Jesus. And then in this church, the path to spiritual growth and making a difference is getting in a group, in relationship, engaging in God's word, loving the church, caring for our soul and lifting our city. That's what I want you to unite around. Rick Warren said this, if they can put the quote up there, you guys, please do so. And I love this when he says this. He says, our greatest witness to the world will be a group effort, not something we do on our own. You realize that? When Jesus prays that you and I, as followers of him, as his followers, he prays that we have perfect unity. Now that's a high bar. I've never seen perfect unity, but I've seen a lot of unity. If you read some point in time, go back to Psalm 133, it says, where unity is, God commands the blessing. Man, to live a blessed life and live in a blessed church, unity is required. And you guys are so unified around all of this stuff. It's amazing. This is just an encouragement. Let's keep it up. Let's keep it up. And if you're sitting here today, or maybe you're online and you've never placed your faith in Jesus, Jesus prays for you as well. Turn your eyes back to John 17 just for a moment. Here's what he says in verse 24. He says, Father, I want these whom you have given me to be with me where I am. Then they can see all the glory you gave me because you loved me even before the world began. Do you hear his heart? Jesus, the one in John 1 who God became flesh and dwelt amongst them, there before creation, he prays to the Father and he says, Father, I want all these that you've given me, all these that you've created to be with me in eternity, to see my glory. It's almost like if I were just to kind of to stretch this a little bit, he's saying, Daddy, let them come over to my house because I want them to see my room. It is awesome. And he prays that for you and for me. And he invites you into relationship with him. Let's bow our heads for just a moment. And I want to pray for us. Father God, thank you for your grace. God, thank you for your goodness. Father, I pray right now for my friends that are here in the room or who may be joining us online that don't yet know you in a personal, meaningful way. Would you speak to their heart right now? Would you draw them towards you? Heads bowed and eyes closed, allow me to speak to you for just a moment. Maybe you don't know Jesus. Maybe you've been going to church for a long time, but you've never really stepped across that line of faith, that line of trust, to place your eternity in the hands of God, your Creator. Maybe the church has somehow hurt you. And I get it. That stinks. But try to put it aside and look past the brokenness of people and look to the perfection of God your Father, who loves you and gave his life for you. Maybe you're here today, you didn't even know what you're getting into, but someone who loves you invited you, and all of a sudden you're just like, what is going on right now? Something's going on in me. That's the Spirit of God drawing you to Christ. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I want to invite you to pray a prayer of just saying, Jesus, I give my life to you. I trust that you are the Son of God, that you've died for me and risen from the dead. And I want to live my life as a follower of Christ. If that's you, heads bowed, eyes closed, you say, Scott, include me in that prayer. I want to make Jesus my Savior today, right now. If that's you, raise your hand real high. Just be bold. Lift it up. Let me see who I get. Like three of you right over here, just raise your hand. Praise God for you. Who else? Sir, I see you up there. That's awesome. Who else? Scott, include me in this prayer. I'm putting my faith in Christ. Who else? Giving my life to Jesus. I see your hand back here, your hand right over here. Online, do the same thing. Just as a little gentle expression of faith, lift your hand and say, that's me. I want to give my life to him. Look at me for just a moment, if you could, please. If you just lifted your hands. I did the same thing. It's been a while. But I'm telling you, if you will follow Jesus moving forward, He will change your life. I'm just telling you from experience. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I want you to say these words full of faith. And we're going to say it with you. We're all going to pray with you. Let's again just get in a posture of prayer. Let's all say this aloud. Say, Father God, today I give you my life. You've created me. Father, forgive me for my sin, for my mess. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God, that you've died on the cross for me. I also believe that you've risen from the grave and you're alive because death cannot hold you because you're the Son of God. Fill me with your Spirit. Help me live in such a way that brings glory to your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's put our hands together. Congratulations. Celebrate if you made that decision. That's awesome. Congratulations. Man, that is awesome. You know, we have a way that we'd love to contact you if you're interested in a conversation. I think we have a QR code that I didn't ask them to get this ready, but if we do have it, they're going to put it on the screen for you, and you can just hold your phone up to it and scan it. If not, I want you to join with our prayer team that will be in this room right under here after the service, and they'd love to talk to you. They'd love to pray with you. And they're not going to pray green bean prayers. They're going to pray God's purpose over your life, and they're going to get after it with you guys, okay? I don't know if Matt's convinced Marshall or Wes to move to Houston yet, but since they're here, should we try to get one more song out of them? You think so? Come on, let's let them know how much we love them, you guys. Let's make some noise.
Okay, so this last song, you guys, if you grew up listening to gospel like I did, good gospel music is a good story. You know what I mean? And this song is actually a country song from, I think, the 70s? And Wes is actually 86 years old. He just looks really, really good. But I hope you just enjoy it. If you want to sing along, you can. But we're just going to tell you a story as we finish today, all right?
Among the local taverns, there'll be a slack in business. As Jesse's drinking came before the groceries and the rest. Among the local women, there'll be a slack in cheating. Cause Jesse won't be stepping out again.
Come on, boy.
They baptized Jesse Taylor in Cedar Creek last Sunday. Jesus gained a soul and saved. Knuckles were more than just respected. The county courthouse records tell all there is to tell. Pockets of the gamblers will soon miss Jesse's money, and the black eye of the law will soon be wet.
Time he went under for the Lord.
baptized in this room. Come on, make some noise.
Now on Nancy Taylor can proudly speak to neighbors and tell them how much Jesse took up with little Jim. Now Jimmy's got a daddy and Jesse's got a family. And Franklin County's got a lot more men. They baptized Jesse Taylor in Cedar Creek last Sunday. Jesus gained a soul.
Take care.